Hi, Paul. You are warmly welcome to Defence Strategic Government Board. Today we are going to discuss on some allegations thrown against Sri Lankan security forces, saying that they were involved in war crimes by so-called international right groups. So what do you think of it?
Yeah, I think one thing we have to realize is everything is political. You know, when people talk of human rights, almost all of them have agendas. And very clearly their agenda for a long time was to stop the Sri Lankan government dealing with terrorism. So in order to do that, they kept what the LTT said hidden. You know, when I used to tell them this in the past, they said, no, we criticized the LTT. I mean, I actually analyzed the Human Rights Watch report, I can't remember now, 18 paragraphs, 14 about the Sri Lankan government, two about both, two about the LTT. And this at a time when everyone was saying very, very clearly that the LTT was to enforce conscription, was killing people who were trying to escape, was actually abusing mothers who were trying to protect their children. All that evidence is there, but nobody cared. So we have to recognize that taking these people seriously is only done by other people who have a political agenda. And now we know Mr. Miliband took this seriously because he wanted to win votes. He has confessed as much to the Americans, and the Americans realized this. But for their own reasons, they also did not be, were not as tough with him as they should have been. They needed support in Iraq. So this world is composed of immoral people. Now, with regard to the allegations against us, what really worries me is the total lack of academic engagement. Whenever anything is produced, first it has a clear reason. So you will remember Channel 4 thing came out at the time the UN was meeting in September. This year, they produced photographs which coincided with our foreign minister going to meet the British Foreign Secretary. Then Channel 4 came out with more pictures just before the president was due to speak to the Oxford Union. I mean, any fool can see that this is coming out with a purpose. But also, story changes each time. When Channel 4 produced their first set of videos a year ago, they claimed that these had been taken in January 2009. We showed, proved that the script on the camera said July 2009. So what they said was obviously untrue. They actually produced so-called experts to argue against our experts. Our experts weren't paid. You know, there were people from the military with video experience. There was a chap called Sri Lanka, highly respected. And he, totally out of the blue, wrote to us and said, this is why I think it's false. Now what happens? They claim that somebody taking the picture in January could have added the date July in order to disguise who he was. And this is madness, no? Secondly, and this I think is the funniest, we showed that a man who died had a leg like this, which went like that. The leg moved after he died. Now what is the explanation that Philip Palestine's expert has? People say the UN says these are true. No one reads the reports. The UN experts have said very, very clearly that they find this leg cannot be explained. So how do they try to explain it? Let me read from you. Right? It has not been established whether this person was already deceased or merely wounded, intoxicated, sleeping, or possibly even uninjured and feigning. Now there are people shooting people all over and he's supposed to be sleeping. It's complete rubbish. But no one reads this report. So Channel 4 says, UN says it is true. UN says, some of the reasons we gave they think are not correct, but two things they can't explain. Now what happens? Channel 4 claims this is the same video extension. But Human Rights Watch says this shows terrible things can happen in May. Now January is forgotten. The people who gave the report were supposed to have said January, that is forgotten. It's now May. Meanwhile, they say this is a woman who was in Manic Farm, which I believe wasn't meant to be May. So you know, these people, when they see things that are false, they continue to tell their story. And as you know, if you tell a story loud enough, some idiots will believe it. I'm afraid this is a stunning indictment of the hypocrisy of people who claim to be interested in human rights and, as you said very rightly, have not bothered about the horrendous evidence of our servicemen, taken into custody, tortured, and killed. Nobody cares.
Now, when we're discussing on the 26 million persons of Sri Lanka Army and Navy who were abducted and held there for 3 years as prisoners of war and had been severely tortured, killed and burned before they were buried in mass graveyard at secret hideout at Vallipuram in Mulladeep Jungle on 6 January 2009. This has been revealed by LTT suspects who were allegedly involved in the killing and are now in custody. This was one of minor scale atrocities committed by LTT terrorists during the last 30 years. And this is a clear evidence of a mass murder. What is your comment on that?
Well, as I said before, it seemed to be very clear that the world doesn't care. Of course, they'll now say there's no point caring because the LTT is over. But we know perfectly well there are people trying to revive the LTT, which is why it's important to point out what a horrible organization it was. So that's one thing. No one is interested. If the world is not sympathetic to someone who has shown them how to do things our way, they want to do things their way. We succeeded our way. The rest of the world is not succeeding in defeating terrorism, partly because they are really not very good at treating civilians properly. All that evidence has come out, unlike us. You know, I'm not saying we're 100% perfect, but compared with any other country in the world, we need more facilities. That is clear. But here, you have a situation where for many years, as you said, Ajax were held. The ICRC was meant to visit. Either the ICRC deliberately closed its eyes to this, but I don't think that's the case. You know, sometimes you think these people are horrible. They're just foolish. I have been to that camp. It was a horrible place. And don't forget, it was not only our servicemen, it was Tamil civilians who were brutally treated there as well. And all of this was going on when the ICRC was supposed to visit. If they had done, bothered to check with the civilians there around about, they would have known what was going on, but they didn't know. You know, they wouldn't allow them. Now, all this was happening. Some of it was revealed in certain reports. There's an agency called the University Teacher for Human Rights. It sometimes gets things wrong, but they admit when they get things wrong. But on the whole, they're sincere. They say they think very critical of government, and I think we should look at this. And if, when we show that they're wrong, they admit they're wrong. They did so with regard to the ACF case in Mutu. They pointed this out a long time ago, but we were not being told by the UN. I mean, it's a bit like I told the UN this. They never revealed the fact that the LTT was conscripting one person per family. And when I told the new UN head in Sri Lanka, he's not a bad man. He said, no, no, we have revealed this. I said, show me one example. He was an honest man. He came back and said, no, I'm sorry, we only had it in our internal documents. And I said, that's the point. You fellows are not going to criticize the LTT because you're terrified. So we have to put up with this. But I hope people will realize that this is a force that is the most appalling things to our servicemen, to Tamil civilians, to other Tamil former militants. And until the world recognizes us, I don't think we should take the people to decide us at all decisions.
Now there will be an issue. Recently some opposition politicians have joined with LTT remnants in UK, accused the government of war crimes and tarnishing the country's image. My question is, can it be possible to comment on such a manner as LTT supported, since they are being members of parliament who are sworn to protect the constitution and the territorial integrity of Sri Lanka? And this is clearly supporting terrorism. How do you think?
Well, my view is politicians tend to do what is convenient for them. Sometimes they do incredibly foolish things. And I think Mr. Karuchara's his interview was bad. It was not worthy of a senior politician. And of course he said things that no intelligent person would say. You know, he says things like, Asian countries are not as serious as about democracy as the West. We have seen from WikiLeaks that, you know, Western democracy also has a lot of things suspicious about it. Political leaders do what they want to do. So for a man to say such a foolish thing shows that he's trying to, let's say, win favor with people rather than actually looking at the Sri Lankan interests. The case of Dr. Jala, there was an enlightenment was different in that they should, I think, rightly set up an investigative committee to look into what he said. My reading is that he is a very cunning person. I think he also used the UNP organizer in London, who's a man called Roger Srinivasan. And I told him that UNP shouldn't have people like that. And he said, well, I was democratically elected, which is the first time the UNP has elected anyone democratically ever, I think, in the last 10 years. So I'm afraid these are people who try to get advantage out of, you know, short-term pleasures and attacking government. But I think the Sri Lankan people have shown them very clearly that it is not the way to become a political successful leader.
So, thank you very much, sir.